Good evening and welcome to our radio lecture. For this radio lecture, we are going to consider the topic learning theories and the applications in education. Learning is a term or a word we use every day, especially students and teachers. But what exactly is learning? Learning is a broad concept and occurs across such a variety of subjects that defining it concisely is not simple. For instance, some psychologists defined learning as a change in behavior as a result of experience. Others define learning as a change in knowledge, which is stored in memory. Still, others define learning as the process of adjusting our mental models or patterns to accommodate our new experiences. Let me unpack the first definition, a change in behavior as a result of experience. Let's assume that a primary school child is taught how to recite the multiplication table 2 times. If the child is able to say 2 times 1 is equal to 2, 2 times 2 is equal to 4, 2 times 3 is equal to 6, and so on correctly, then we can conclude there is a change in the behavior of the child as a result of the encounter or the experience he had with the teacher. Before the lesson, the child didn't know how to recite the multiplication table 2 times. Therefore, learning is defined as a change in someone's behavior as a result of experience or interaction with the environment. Our topic is about learning theories. So let me define what we mean by learning theories. Learning theories are organized set of principles that explain how individuals acquire, retain, and record knowledge. Perhaps most of you may be wondering why we are talking about learning in educational technology class. Well, learning theories are very important for educational technologists and instructional designers, because for you to be able to effectively integrate technology in teaching or create an effective and engaging instruction, you should understand how people acquire, retain, and record knowledge. There are several theories of learning, but all theories of learning can be grouped under 3 main paradigms or schools of thought. A paradigm or a school of thought is a particular way of thinking about something or the real world. And so we are going to discuss how certain groups of people think about or understand how people acquire, retain, and recall knowledge. The first learning paradigm or school of thought is called behaviorism. There are a number of theories associated with behaviorism, but because of time factor, we will not go into details. We will just talk about the general characteristics of behaviorism. But I'll give you an example of behaviorism. Classical conditioning and operant conditioning theories. Behavior theorists believe that knowledge exists independently and outside the learner. In other words, the learner as a blank slate or tabula rasa who must be provided with all the learning experiences. Expressed differently, it means that learner's mind is empty. There is nothing in the learner's mind. And so for that matter, it's the responsibility of the teacher to pump ideas or knowledge into the learner's mind. The learning actually occurs when new behaviors or behaviors are acquired through association between stimuli and responses. Thus, association leads to a change in behavior. to the behaviorist, the learning process is based on objectively observable changes in behavior. Behaviorists define learning simply as the acquisition of a new behavior or change in behavior. The theory is that learning begins when a stimulus from the environment is presented and the learner reacts to the stimulus with some type of response. Consequences that reinforce desired behavior are arranged to follow the desired behavior. For instance, a student will study for a test and get a good grade. The new behavioral pattern can be repeated so that it becomes automatic. The change in behavior of the learner signifies that learning has occurred. Teachers use behaviorism when they reward or punish students' behavior. Now let's consider some educational implications of behaviorism. In other words, how we can apply behaviorism principles in the classroom or in education. One, instruction should be provided gradually or little by little, from simple to complex, and the subsequent should build on the previous one. Material to be learned should be arranged systematically and sequential step, from simple to complex. Students are encouraged to progress at their own pace. Teachers should encourage learners' participation. Teachers should reinforce behavior in their students which they wish to be repeated. Evaluation should be encouraged with prompt feedback. Instructors should behaviorism have been criticized on a number of grounds. There is a belief that behaviorism does not prepare the learner for problem solving or creative thinking. Do what they are told and do not take the initiative to change or improve things. The learner is only prepared for recall of basic facts, automatic responses, or performing tasks. Now let's move on to the second learning paradigm, cognitivism. In some books, they are referred to as cognitive information processing. Cognitive information processing is based on the thought process behind the behavior. In other words, the behaviorist will focus on the change, but for the cognitive, we should rather consider what in the learner's mind, which behavior to occur. Now, the theory is the idea that humans process the information they receive rather than mere responding to stimuli. In other words, individuals think about whatever is happening in their environment. The changes in behavior are observed, but indicate to what is going on in the learner's mind. The learner is like a mirror from which new knowledge and skills will be reflected. Cognitive information processing is used when the learner plays an active role in seeking ways to understand and process information that he or she receives and relates what is already known and stored within memory. Cognitive theorists believe through internal processing of information. Unlike behaviorism, cognitive information processing is governed by an internal process rather than by external circumstance. The cognitive approach to learning theory pays more attention to what goes on inside the learner's head and focuses on mental processes rather than observable behavior. Changing behavior observed and used as indicators as to what's happening inside the learner's mind. Today, learning reorganization of experiences, either attaining insights or changing old ones. Thus, learning is a change in knowledge which is stored in memory and not change in behavior. Let's discuss how cognitivist principles can be applied in the classroom situation. There is the need for teachers to learn concepts, in other words, associate new content with something that students already know. There is also the need for instructors or teachers to organize lecture in efficient and meaningful ways. It is also important to use real-world examples. Instructors should also involve their learners by employing the discussion method. Instructors should also speak aloud so that learners can hear clearly what they are saying. The learner will be able to process the information that they receive if they get it clearly. If it's not clear to them, then they cannot work on it. Instructors write clearly so that learners can see. Instructors should also do well to get learners' attention and interest. Learners should also be motivated by instructors. It is also important for instructor to give a piece of information at a time. Instructors should also encourage learners to rehearse information. Now we are moving on to the third paradigm, and the third paradigm is called constructivism. Constructivism is based on the premise that we all construct our own perspective of the world based on individual experiences and internal knowledge. To the constructivist, learning is based on how the individual interprets and creates the meaning of his or her experiences. Knowledge is constructed by the learner. And since everyone has a different set of experiences and perceptions, learning is unique and different for each person. To the constructivist, learning is a process where individuals construct new ideas or concepts based on previous knowledge and or experiences. Each of us generates our own mental models or way of thinking, which is used to make sense of our experiences. Individuals resolve conflicts between ideas and reflect on theoretical explanations. To the constructivist, activist. Learning is simply the process of adjusting our mental to accommodate our new experiences. Used to focus on preparing people to solve problems by themselves. Therefore, to be successful, the learner needs a significant base of knowledge upon which to interpret and create ideas. Moreover, with constructivism, outcomes are not always predictable, because learners are constructing their own knowledge. Therefore, constructivism does not work with a result constructivism does not work when the result we are looking for is supposed to be consistent. Are the educational implications of constructivism? Now, the goal of instruction is not to teach information, but rather we need to create situations or learning environment that will enable the student to interpret information from their own understanding. The teacher should also serve or act as a facilitator, guiding and supporting learners in the process of constructing knowledge. Learning should be situated in relevant and realistic context. The learning environment should be the direct replica of real-life situations. Teachers should make use of case studies, research projects, brainstorming method of teaching. Teachers should also make use of collaborative learning or group work. It is also important for teachers to make use of discovery learning. Now, the question is, which of these theories or paradigms should the teacher adopt? Now, all theories are important, or paradigms. Now, when a teacher is deciding on which strategies to use, it is important to consider certain factors. Now, it is important to consider the level of knowledge of the learners. You have to consider the age and the privilege of the learners. It is also important to consider the learning goal. Is the presentation of new ideas, or the teacher just want a single response or answer? It is also important to consider the complexity of the content to be delivered. Now, when the learning task requires practice and repetition, it may be best to employ drill and practice, which is a behaviorism principle of learning. Now, on the other hand, when the learning task requires understanding and the development of concepts, it may be best to use cognitivist approach. Now, so for collaboration, knowledge acquisition, problem solving are consistent with a constructivist perspective. So the question that I posed earlier on, that which of these paradigms or approaches do we have to adopt? And I said it depends on the situation. So I'm going to summarize what I have presented so far. Now, we talked about three paradigms or three learning paradigms. We talked about behaviorism. We talked about cognitivism. We also touched on constructivism. For the behaviors, new behaviors or changes in behaviors are acquired through associations between stimuli and response. Cognitivists believe that learning occurs through internal processing of information. Constructivists believe that we construct our own knowledge of the world based on individual experiences. So we are going to open the phone lines, and I'm going to call the studio lines. I repeat, 0 3 9 2 3 1 5 8 and 0 3 2 3 2 0 2 0 1. Radio.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening. It depends on the situation, but it's important for you to blend the approaches, because now is okay. I talked about the weaknesses inherent in the behaviorist perspective, and the cognitive too, they are weaknesses, because Imagine you are teaching, you can't just leave everything into the hands of the student. If you are, okay, let's say, applying the
inherent in the
cognitive
and the cognitive the weaknesses,
through
because imagine you are teaching
classroom and
everything into your love,
do not have
student, if
adequate enough experiences. It means the
cognitive
experience experiences will be than those who do not have experiences. So, need for you to blend the approaches. The studio lines 0392 3158 and 0332 320 01. There is a caller.
Hello.
Hello. Good evening.
I am Solomon Kunamba from the Integrated Science Department.
Okay.
What is the similarities between
the similarities?
Is there similarity between
In both, they believe that, okay, now I made a point that the behaviors they focus on what we see outside, or behavioral changes, they focus on what happens outside. Now the cognitive also believe that it's, we can observe outside, but we must also focus on whatever is going inside the learner's mind, because to the behavior there is nothing in the learner's mind. The learner does not know anything, and so it is up to the teacher to or the learner respond to environmental stimuli. The cognitive is saying that, well, I will look at whatever is happening outside, but I believe something going on inside the learner, and that is why maybe he was able to perform that activity. Now the constructivists also believe that we construct our knowledge as we interact with one another, and so in that we can say that something happened outside, okay, but as the the behavior what is happening outside, neglecting what is going on inside the learner. Studio lines 0503 923 158 and 0332 320 01. I'm reading some of your text messages. I am Bedu Ebenezer from Political Science Department. Please, my question is, can you please explain to me the cognitivism and instructivism? I don't think we didn't talk about the instructivism. We talked about cognitivism and constructivism. And do you have a specific question? Do you have a specific question that you want to address, you want us to address? Now, I said that the cognitivist focuses more on what happened inside the learner's mind rather than the behavior. Okay, they process information that they receive. They don't respond to environmental stimuli as is the perspective of the behaviorist. To the behavior, like the teacher is teaching primary one multiplication table, and the teacher has written, let's say, two times on a card. So the teacher will repeat 2022, then the student will also recite the same or repeat the same thing, and then until they learn to recite the multiplication table. Okay, now to the is the to what teacher is telling them to do, but I believe that well, some there is a change in behavior. The student the learner is able to recite information, but before student you say the student did or the learner did not respond to the stimuli that presented to him or her. Okay, studio lines 0392 31 58 and 0232 0001. So to the cognitivists, the change in behavior must be observed, but it is also an indication to what is going on inside the learner's head. There's a caller on the line.
The theory you presented is wrong. From political science department. I said I want to know the importance of the theories you presented. I said I want you to tell us the importance of the theory you presented today.
I think when I started the presentation, I said you may be talking about learning theories in edutech class, and I said for even integrated technology, you should understand how people acquire, how they retain, how they recall, and if you are educational technologist or instructional designer, for you to be able to create an engaging and effective instruction, you understand the way you learn. So these choices are very important, because you know, when standing in front of you, the way you behave, compose himself or herself, the teacher is influenced by theories. Okay, so it is important for you to learn and for you to understand how people acquire knowledge and how they are able to retain the information. And even as a student, it is also for you to understand people, how to retain information and how they acquire them. That is the only way you can even succeed as a student. Studio lines 0032 31 58 and 0332 320201. WhatsApp and text 0392 31 58. The numbers again 0392 31 01. There is a caller on the line.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I'm Benjamin Mawon Sani from Political Science Department. So I want to know, apart from the three theories that you spoke about, is any other theory that can be observed in the teaching and learning process?
Okay, I said earlier on that there are several learning theories. In fact, there are many, but all theories can be grouped under three paradigms, learning paradigms. Okay, so maybe the one that you are thinking of will form one of these. So there are several of them, but they can be grouped under three main headings or school. Okay. 0303 92 31 58 0 32 32 02 10 1 0 5 0 3 9 2 3 1 5 8 and 0 3 3 2 3 2 0 2 0 1 WhatsApp and text 0503 92 31 58 and 0 3 2 3 2 0 2 0 1 WhatsApp and text 0503 92 31 58. There's a caller on the line. Please, do you your volume?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Please, I'm Odoi Bright from Political Science Department.
Okay.
Okay, so please, when we say you need to consider the previous experience of learner, is it the personal life of the student or the previous learning session? What was learned or the personal life of the student?
No, you see, when it comes to learning, every experience is important. We about what perspective. It is the what student was talking about, but just life experiences. That is what we are talking about.
Okay.
Studio line 0503 92 31 58 03 32 32 02 01 WhatsApp and text You can put your messages on Facebook page, Radio DB 98.3 FM. Studio lines 0503 92 31 58 and 0 3 2 3 2 0 2 0 1. WhatsApp and text 0 3 9 2 3 1 5 8. Facebook page Radio DB 98.3 FM. I'm reading some of your test messages. I am Raymond from Political Science Department. In understanding the various learning theories, which one should best be inculcated in student and at what stages of learning? Okay, it depends. You know, they can all be employed at various levels, primary school, GHS, senior, high, or even university. But you see, you need to consider the content, and you also have to consider the age of the learners. So that will influence how you are going to adopt the method. Remember, I set an example that if you are the material that you are presenting, you know, has to do with student ability to remember or recite, then you have to use the behaviorist perspective or approach, because that helps students to memorize information quickly. And so we call it the drill and practice, where I think during our time, you go to school Monday morning. That is where they will do something we call mental. That is drill. Okay? So it depends on the objective of the lesson. If you want your student to be able to generate ideas, then you have to use the cognitive approach or the constructivist approach. Okay, I'm reading your messages from WhatsApp. I am John from Political Science Department. If there is no change in behavior after learning, please say what can be given to that. It means not taking place. If there is no behavior, because a change in behavior as a result of experience, it's called learning, or a change in knowledge is called learning. So no change, then there is no learning. Okay, please, I am Tete Vida Yomli, a political science student. Please, what are the importance of behaviorism? I think somebody asked this question, and I said that it was different. Several purposes, and one of them is the drill and practice that I talked about earlier. So if you want your student to be able to memorize information and to be able to recite them, then you have to use behavior, because one of the approaches or the methods is drill and practice. And then, if you want a change, I think that's a question. I think the person wanted to know whether these theories can also be applied outside the classroom. The answer is yes, and that in education. Now, so let's say you are a parent and you want your child to learn. So you take, okay, if you do, you can watch television. Now, if you don't do your homework, you are not going to watch television. Okay, so here you are applying the behaviorist principle. Okay, you are withdrawing something so that the learner will do something. That is why we call reinforcement. So we have negative reinforcement and then we have positive reinforcement. So with the negative reinforcement, is characterized by the removal of the unpleasant outcome after the desired behavior. So, but what your child is interested, then it will force the child to do what you want the child to do. This is from Millicent. Political science. So my question is, if the person have learned things, the things also get knowledge, but he or she have not changed. Now, maybe you are taking it to, I mean, literally. Are you talking about maybe not? I started the presentation by explaining what we mean by behavioral change or a change in behavior. Now, if let's say before you presented the lesson, okay, your student knew about the topic, or they didn't know what you were going to talk about. Now, after the presentation, now they know how to talk about it. They are able, if it's economic factors that influence demand. Now, to tell you the factors, it means that in behavior, hitherto they didn't know that by a change in behavior. This has nothing to do with maybe your friend is misbehaving in a negative manner, and your friend is not changing. That's not what we are talking about. Okay, this is different. Okay, the studio lines 0392 3158 and 0332 320201, WhatsApp and text 0392 3158, Facebook page Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. There's a on the line.
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Good evening.
Sir, please, in trying to know, how do you get to know a student's previous life experience when one you don't live from, especially when you don't live with them?
Would you mind your audio?
Hello again, sir.
Good.
Yes, good evening, sir.
Good.
Yes, good evening, sir.
Good.
Hello.
Hi. Yeah, you.
I'm saying that how would an instructor be able to know the student's previous life experience when the instructor is not living with the students or the learner?
Okay. Is it about a constructivist or a cognitivist? Okay, now if it's about constructivism, now what you are saying that we construct knowledge, okay, through social negotiation as we interact with other people. All right, so that I'm talking about here, you see, as teachers, we must not stay with the student or the learning experiences of the learner. Are saying is that now when you are teaching as a teacher, the lesson is empty, tabula rasa, or blank slate, and so they have different ideas. You have to the teaching and learning process. And that is why when you start teaching, okay, we talk about knowledge, okay, and we start from known to unknown. So the experience is what are they already. Okay, I'll give you an example. Now we are going to talk about or the talk about the process from them. How have entered the process or put the letter before? Have you seen the start before? Have you seen an experiences? Okay, from unknown, you are made of their knowledge. I'm reading some of your messages. Please, sir, can you go through the weaknesses of the three learning theories? Now, we said that the behaviors assume that the learner knows nothing, and so to ideas. And that approach is not lead to problem solving, or it doesn't encourage students to solve problems, because it focuses on reasoning, okay, ability to memorize information and then produce them. Now, somebody also, I think, asked a question about experiences. Now, if you build upon the experiences of the learners in teaching, a point earlier that a particular does not have adequate enough experiences, then it means that learner is going to suffer. Now, believe it or not, the learners in the class, let's say if you have 40 students, some and so you to consideration. That is why we have to go by the principle that not the learners are not they are not equal, or they are not the same. They differ in terms of even the level at which they may be operating. They don't be in the same classroom, but they may differ in terms of their experience, life experiences, their socioeconomic background. And as a teacher, you have to take that into consideration when you are teaching, so that you'll be able to meet all your student needs. Studio 0392315 and 0332320201 WhatsApp and text 0392315 Okay, somebody, I am Christian from Political Science Department. Please, can you explain to me what is learning? Now, I started my presentation by saying that it is difficult to give an definition, because whatever definition that you give will be subjected to scrutiny. We have different schools of thought as to how people acquire knowledge. There's a caller on the line. I will come back to the question.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Look, my name is Mr. Lawese.
Okay. Please, would you be reducing the volume of your audio?
Hello. Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you.
My name is Mr. Lawese.
Okay.
Yeah, I was trying to link up with you before and Radio Winning Day.
Hello. Okay. So, I'm Christian from Political Science Department. Please, can you explain to me what is learning? Now, so to the behavior, okay, learning is a change of behavior as a result of experience. And I explained using examples that if, let's say, you are teaching primary school children, or people, multiplication timetable, okay, and then you are teaching them, let's say, 2 times 2, and then the 3 times 3, and others. You write them on, let's say, a paper, a card, and you present to them. Once you present, you say, 2 times 4, then they. Now, if at the end, the students are able to recite on their own, okay, anytime let me present to them, this time you are not going to tell them 2 times 2 is equal to 4. If they are able to say it, then we say taking place in their behavior, because before the, okay, so there is a change in their behavior. Now, the cognitivists will also define as a change in knowledge which is stored in memory. So when you acquire new knowledge or new information, you store in your memory. Now, to the constructivists, our pattern or our way of thinking to accommodate our new experiences. So it is to give a universal definition. Okay. We have done that, but I can go over again. All right, so let me summarize what we've learned today. We talked about learning theories, and I said that there are several theories, but they can be categorized or grouped under three main headings or paradigms, learning paradigms or schools of thought. And we talked about behavior, and today behavior through associations between stimulus and response, and through internal and today we of the world based on our individual experiences. So we will draw curtains on our radio lecture for today. Thanks for your participation. Bye for now.